Hello and welcome to this week's Bible study preview. We have a special Bible study this weekend. It's our first part of our stewardship challenge, a God-lived life, something we'll do once a month for 4 months here. The first month is about stewardship of God's truth. We have a short video that will serve as an introduction today, so we'll let you watch that video right now.
Sticking with the routine is hard, but we all do it, in one way or another, even if we don't realize it. After all, God has made us all creatures of habit, and that's really what it boils down to when it comes to living a life of a disciple and being in God's Word regularly. Because how many Christians, true followers of Christ, do you know who don't read God's Word as much as they could be because they don't want to? Let's be honest. It's all about keeping a habit, which is hard work, even if we are completely committed. Science actually tells us this. In a recent study, we can see that people who are the most successful at keeping habits are not people with the strongest willpower. Instead, the people who are able to keep habits are those who eliminate the roadblocks that prevent them from keeping those habits. So brothers and sisters in Christ who are motivated by the love of Jesus, and just as the Apostle Peter encourages, rid yourselves of all malice and all deceit, hypocrisy, envy, and slander of every kind. Let's get rid of the bad to make room for the good. Just think about how many unproductive things we fill our days with that get in the way of us getting that spiritual milk that we all need so badly. And by the grace of God, we can, led and refreshed daily by God's Holy Spirit. So our challenge is this. Rid yourselves of the roadblocks. Pray for strength to create a new routine and live the life God created just for you. A God-lived life. The life of a disciple.
That video did a good job of just explaining what we're trying to do with this challenge, is to build a routine of Bible study that then God can use to bless our lives in lots of different ways. So before we talk about what a God-lived life looks like, we have to talk about the only thing that, you know, produces a God-lived life in us. Just for way of illustration, think of it, if you're going to cook, I don't know if you love cooking out there, maybe some of you do, but before you cook anything, what do you have to do? Well, you have to go to the grocery store to make sure that you have food. So that's a necessary step before you make your delicious meal for yourself or your family. You gotta make sure you have the materials in your home to actually produce that meal. If you are going to go for a drive, you know, your nice drive to work or your drive to just look around at the fall foliage or whatever you love to do when you're in your car, before you do that, you have to, of course, stop and get gas. So before we have a God-lived life, there's an important starting place, which is making sure we appreciate God's Word, understand its purpose for our lives, and then set up a pattern by which God can use His Word to bless us. We won't do a ton from our worksheet today. We'll save that for our Zoom studies. But just let's maybe do the first two here. There's sort of an interesting introductory activity in which someone in the group is supposed to play the devil's advocate. And the devil's advocate says, I went to Sunday school when I was younger. I go to church. I know what Jesus did for me. You can't tell me that I need to read the Bible on my own at home or go to Bible study at church. So here's someone that is faithful in worship. You know, they put in the time in Sunday school when they were younger, maybe at their parents' or grandparents' encouragement. And they say, I don't need any more than what I'm currently doing. And so there's a list of passages here that explain how we might respond to either that feeling inside of us or someone who shares that opinion with us. So let's just do the first two. John 17:17, Jesus says, sanctify them by the truth. your word is truth. What does that have to say to that idea of I don't really need Bible study? Well, I think you probably can tell in our world, in terms of just the concept of truth, the very idea of truth is under attack and has been for quite a while. So a lot of people in our world kind of feel like this guy about truth or just the pursuit of anything real or objective in general. Just I don't really know what truth is, and you can't tell me what truth is, and it's kind of wrong for you to insist that the idea of truth is a thing in general. So part of Bible study is just being confirmed in that idea that God's word is the truth. We go back to that word over and over again, and it sustains us in our efforts to live out God's word. But also just that when we're not in God's word, all these other ideas creep in from our culture, or we have a sinful nature that produces all these ideas that make more sense to us. So if you don't spend time in God's truth, other things that seem true to us will sneak in. The second one there, also from the Gospel of John, but these are written that you may believe that Jesus is the Christ, the Son of God, and that by believing you may have life in his name. What is the key to all of Scripture? Well, it's the cross. This time in Scripture is the time that we get to go back to what God has done for us in Christ, and it's the key to our faith. So if God says the means of grace, word, and sacrament are the key to a relationship with him and believing in Jesus and having eternal life in heaven, doesn't that translate into then we should be spending as much time as we possibly can in God's word? If it's the truth and it's the key to heaven, then absolutely does make sense that we should carve out time for God's word, and probably more time than we be given right now. Overall, in this study and in this series as a whole, just cultivating this attitude toward Scripture and toward living it out like a kid. You've got a picture here of a kid at a birthday party. You just think how when a kid knows it's their birthday, and even a couple days before their birthday, they sometimes say, okay, only 2 more days, 1 more day, or they say 2 more sleeps or 1 more sleep till my birthday. And just this general sense of I cannot wait for this thing. And then the day of a kid's birthday, maybe they're having a birthday party, they just can't sit still. I can't contain my excitement. There's just this good thing that's about to happen. To have that sort of general excitement about God's word and appreciation for what God does through that word in our lives, just spending time in God's word and allowing God to cultivate that attitude inside of us. One of the sections we'll look at in our study is Psalm 1. And Psalm 1 is a great lesson, or a great section, I should say, just for talking through what the benefits of studying God's word are. And it says, blessed are the people who spend time in God's word. And one of the things it says there, it talks about delight. Blessed are those who delight in God's word. And the idea behind the Hebrew word there in delight is to feel rich. So that when you are studying God's word, you just feel rich, like there's so much good stuff for you to study. It's overwhelming how many good things God has to reveal to you in his word. It also says that those who study God's word are like a tree planted by streams of water. So a tree that is healthy and strong, that can endure difficult times, and not only can endure and just withstand the winds of this world, but also a tree that produces fruit that's healthy. And the way the Bible uses that picture of fruit is often that you're doing what God calls you to do. Think of those fruits of faith in Galatians 5, love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, self-control, just contentment, a general, you're following after Jesus in your life. So the blessings of appreciating God's word, that it is like a treasure. And then what does that do for me? Well, God's word produces in me all of those beautiful fruits. The last thing we'll touch on for today is 1 Peter talks about like newborn babies crave spiritual milk. They need it. They want it because it sustains them and helps them grow. To have that same attitude about God's word. I got to have it. When I don't have it, when I have to miss church or miss Bible study for some reason, it feels like something's off in my week. And when I do make time for it, I do realize that God is helping me grow. All right, that's all for this week. Look forward to talking through this first lesson with you in the Zoom classes. God bless.